title of the sermon's All the Way In. Everybody say All the Way In. All the Way In. Not some of the way in, not a partial way. All the Way In. And I need today to be a good day because this week was a little rough. Anybody had a rough week? Yeah, so my family, we embarked on the football season. And, you know, I'm not so sure that I like the, like, Christian school football thing. So my son goes to a Christian school. I didn't go to a Christian school. We was nowhere close to Christianity growing up. Can I get amen? Anybody go to public school? Where are my public people at? Hey, it ain't like that no more, y'all. My son goes to a Christian school, and, you know, I want my son to be a part of, like, a team where they got a mascot that's, like, just angry. It's like an angry bear, just, ah, ah, ah. Or like a tiger or a lion or a mean shark. I love our school, but, like, we're eagles. So, like, we'll fly all over you. You know what I mean? So, like, so he's getting into this football thing, and I have how I grew up and how we did it, and it's a little different than the way I did. I showed it to my son's game an hour early, and I was the only dude there. I grew up North Memphis. You better get there early. Yeah. And I sat down on the bleacher, and I'm, like, ready for the pregame. I got, like, Leah's mascara because I'm fixing to go all the way in. I'm talking about just loud. I'm the dude that's going to get escorted out if my son gets a bad call. Oh, I'm all the way in. I'm invested as a father. Can I get an amen? So I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, okay, I can deal with the eagle thing because at least it's biblical. But, like, you better not hit like an eagle. Dog, you better hit like a bear, like a hungry, angry. Y'all don't think it's scriptural? Psalms 144:1. He has prepared my hands for battle and my feet for war. Yes. That's the scripture you need, Becton. So I'm, like, getting in his face about it. And y'all, I'm sitting on the bleachers ready for, like, the pregame song. Because, like, growing up, that was how we got in. And y'all, you raise me up so I can fly like you. Anybody else bothered by this? Coaches don't want them to hit because they're supposed to hold each other accountable. Football is not a faith sport. Football is a hitting sport. Can I get an amen? Amen. Referees don't call them offsides because Jesus died for both sides. Anybody else bothered by this? We're not going to turn on the scoreboard. No, because everybody in attendance needs the grace of God. I'm like, we don't like them. We don't pray. They pray for them. The visiting team, we pray for. I'm like, we're the Christian school. God likes us. God doesn't like them. I don't need you praying for somebody. I need you hurting somebody. You judge me if you want to, but look, I can't go all the way in on I Can Only Imagine. Surrounded by my teammates, what will my heart feel? Will I dance in the end zone? No, baby. See, y'all, I grew up where before a football game, you just, like, we used to put tinfoil on our teeth and just stare at folk. We did not have mercy me at the football game. Y'all don't remember Bishop Archie, 2002? I had to introduce my son to the way to go all in. I want to see who's my people. Hey! We ready. Where you at? We ready. We ready. Hey, turn that up, huh? I said, Becton, do you know what I mean? Like, all in. He's like, no, Dad, and why are you breathing hard? I said, Becton, I got to help you out with something, man. I got to help you out. if you learn how to go all the way in, the game's better. If you tiptoe through football, it doesn't work. And actually had a great game, great school, great environment, but I had to exaggerate all that for the principle of the day's message. But he did phenomenal, but I would just have to tell. Yeah, losing is not a learning experience. That's a loss. We're just learning humility. No, you got humiliated. There's a difference. Can I get an amen? It's been a rough week. Rough week at the house. Hey, church, if you go all in, the game's better. I propose if you don't go all the way in, the game won't make any sense. I propose a halfway Christianity will leave you frustrated and sitting in the arena or on the bleachers wondering why the game doesn't work, and it's because the game doesn't work good on the bleachers. So God's invitation to you today on Baptism Sunday is to be baptized. Everybody say baptized. Boy, I can't get that song out of my head. We read, doo-doo, doo-doo. Y'all, we used to be on the bus and hit the window. Remember that? Doo-doo, doo-doo, doo-doo. Oh, never mind. Y'all, we have some private school people at the 1045. And Clarence lives at home with both parents. And Clarence's parents have a real good... Ooh, y'all need to be saved. I know all of y'all who just said that out loud. Somebody touch your neighbor and say, pray for our pastor. He just quoted somebody that we don't want to be quoted. Go to Galatians chapter 3. All the way in, all the way in, all the way in, all the way in. The game doesn't work if you don't go all the way in. It's a contact sport. You can't get, the scripture says the purposes of a man's heart are deep waters. You can't get what God has on the surface. It's a contact sport. You only get the treasure if you learn how to dig. And so today I want to talk about going all the way in, and I got 16 minutes to do it, so I'm going to talk a little faster than I have been. Galatians chapter 3 says this, Paul says this, before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody. Anybody ever been in custody?
Yeah.
Our staff's like, held in custody under the law, in custody under the law, locked up until the faith that was to come would be revealed. I wonder how many people cannot go all the way in and experience the life that comes from this game of football, or in our sense, Christianity, and living a life that is an abundant, full of potential life. Perhaps even as free as you and I look this morning, perhaps some of us are actually secretly in custody under the law. Singing about potential, hearing about potential, but perhaps, maybe, just maybe, stuck under the law and not knowing why it's frustrating to try to worship a God that, well, doesn't seem like he's doing his job. Now, the question is, what's the law? What is the law? It said, in custody under the law. What is the law? Well, in the first part of your Bible, God had to deliver the law because it was a new way of living because they had been in slavery for 400 years. So the new law was a new way of living, and there wasn't 10 commandments, y'all. How many of you guys know that's frustrating? Because I'm about 7 out of 10 on a good day. Anybody else? Anybody got all 10 dialed in? No, you don't. You just lied. See, there's 9 right there. In the Old Testament, you have 613 laws. So when Paul is saying this, he said, some of you were under custody. You were locked up with the law. You say, what was the law? The law was the right way to live. What the law actually did, though, was it gave you 613 reasons why you weren't God. Like, as hard as you could try, maybe you could keep 492. What the law was 613 degrees of separation. The law would frustrate you because as much as you wanted to inhabit the promise of God, the law was living proof that you're not God and you can't get there. So like the language of the Old Testament is very clear. You can't. And the law was a measuring device. The law let you know where you stand. Let me ask you a question. I'm going to kind of see what kind of people we have. Is it half full or is it half empty? Where's my half empty people at? You scared to raise your hand because you want to get judged in church. I get it. Let me say it again. We're half empty. Where are we at? Thank you. You're logical, critical people. We need you to raise your hand. Because everybody else is like, oh my God, it's full. And you're like, no, it ain't full. You don't bake a cake that way. Don't bake cookies that way. It is not totally full. So optimism is not ignoring reality. Can I get amen? All right, where am I half full, people? Surprised you didn't cheer. You guys are normally pretty. It's half full. Woo! And then some of us super logical people are like, it's 50%. Who cares? Can I get amen? All right, the purpose of this glass is to be filled to capacity, and the purpose of the glass is to pour. Can I get amen?
Yeah.
The problem with the law is it showed you exactly where you are and where you're not.
Yes.
It's a measuring device. The danger of being in custody with the law is that you'll never measure up. So if you're under the law, that doesn't mean you have to know all the law. There's a lot of us that are under the law that have no clue about the 613 laws. I can tell that you're under the law if you're obsessed with your measurements.
Wow.
How I'm doing in this season. How much longer do I have to go till I get that?
Wow.
Am I like more good than bad, and is that okay? Is my life half full or is it half empty? Like, how much Christian am I? How much am I reading and in my job and my pursuits? Am I like 75% of the way? And if you're not careful, you live life under the law and don't even know it.
Right.
And the reason that we strive, and the reason that we get over busy, and the reason we overcommit in our calendar is because we're living under the law and it's the lifestyle we've chosen.
Yeah.
And so we have questions. Am I good enough? Do I measure up? We're in a generation that obsesses about the type of cup I am and my measurements and my strengths and my weaknesses, and I'm a 7 and I'm an 8 and I'm this and I'm that. And wondering why we're anxious. Maybe, just maybe, we're in custody under the law. Maybe some of my anxiety, maybe some of my fear is the fact that I have godly expectations in a human glass. The scripture says this, all of us have sinned and fallen short. And so we're constantly frustrated if we live under the law because you can never get to 100%. Has anybody else figured out you can be 100% on Sunday and about 30% by Monday? Hey, how many of you guys know you could be 90% on a Monday morning with your quiet time, but by the time you get on I-40, Jesus, Lord. How many of you guys know life leaks?
Yes.
Life leaks.
Yes.
Maybe we're asking the wrong questions. Maybe your life doesn't make most sense when all of your questions are percentage questions. Because if the goal of the glass is to pour, and I'm a percentage thinker, meaning, when are we going to have a kid? We're 30% of the way. If every decision is driven by logic, then every answer will always be can't.
Yeah. Wow.
Because you are not perfect. So there is always a discrepancy between what could be and what is. And we are led around by the can'ts if we live life in the cup being measured. So, like, maybe it's not are you negative or are you positive? Is it half full or is it half empty? Maybe the question isn't what's in me. Maybe the question is, what am I in?
Wow.
I want to change the way that you think today.
Yes.
Because here it is. We are in a season where I believe God wants to do a miracle in your life. But he cannot bypass a measuring mindset and get you to the place he has for you. If you are in control and obsessed with your measurements, you may be missing it. And here's why I think a lot of us could be missing it. I grew up where I thought baptism was a thing that we did at church because we got a certificate and we got a potluck. Can I get an amen? Anybody else know what a potluck is? Ooh, if we had one right now, I could go in all the way in. But for us, we thought baptism, you crawl up, you get in a tank, your parents cheer, you get a certificate. And that is absolutely, positively never the intent of the word baptism. It was never meant to be a moment. I want you to dial in, because I think if you have lived a measuring lifestyle, that's why you're frustrated. And that's why some of you're bored with Christianity, is because you're like, I've already tried this thing. Life leaks and it never gets full. So like, I'm just never living a life where I'm just always full. And it's because I think we're asking the wrong questions. I think we're looking in the mirror of measurements and we're missing the bigger picture. So Paul in Galatians chapter 3 finishes this paragraph and hopefully changes all of our mind to where we can imagine the potential. I want you to go there. Galatians chapter 3, verse 25. Check out what Paul says. Now that this faith has come, let me explain faith, okay? Faith is not illogical. Faith is pre-logical. Some of you need to write that down, because you are smart thinkers, and so you do not move until the measurement says so. The problem with that is, Noah, you would have never built a boat. Peter, you would have never walked on water.
Yeah.
Measured living can stand in the way of miracle living.
Yes.
Now, when Peter was walking on water and you could see it, that's logical. I logically see a man walking on water. But it started by faith. Faith is not illogical, it is pre-logical. And I want all of us today to choose to change our mindset, because if you don't feel good enough, maybe you're asking the wrong question. Here's by faith, it says, we are no longer under a guardian, no longer under the measuring law. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you were, underline this, baptized into Christ. It does not say baptized into a tank. It does not say baptized into water, although you see that all throughout Scripture. Yes. It says we are baptized into Christ. Let me give you the Greek word for baptism. It is baptizo. Do you know what it means? All the way in. It means no part untouched. When Paul is inviting all of us, he's inviting us to go all the way in. So let me give you a better question. The question isn't, do you remember when you were baptized? The question isn't, have you been baptized? If baptizo is not just a water, in fact, I'll show you multiple baptisms in Scripture today, multiple ones. If it's not just about getting in a tank, if it's being baptized into Christ, maybe the question isn't, have you been baptized? Maybe the question is, are you baptized? Wow. Because baptism was never meant to be a moment. Listen, it was meant to be a lifestyle.
Yeah.
And like, it's gonna set you free, because some of you are worried about something you'll never solve.
That's right. Yeah.
Can we just be honest? You're never, ever, 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 ever gonna be 100% all the time. Because the moment that you pour, oh, sorry about that. The moment that you're poor, you are more empty. And what's the purpose of a glass? It's to pour. So some of us are frustrated because when we pour out, we feel empty. And so we start judging ourselves and stepping back and reclusing from the thing that God has called us to do. And it's because we thought baptism was a place and a time and a moment when we were 12. No, it is a lifestyle. Can I show you something that should change the way that you think, and the security that you have and the confidence you have and the boldness that you have to move forward? Baptism is not this. Are you watching? Maybe we should stop measuring and being consumed with our own measurements and understand that baptism is when I go all the way in. This is what being baptized looks like.
Come on.
I'm no longer worried about what I have, what I don't, how good I am, how bad I am, good Sundays, bad Fridays, yin and yang theology. No, 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 no. I could never add up And the reason I chose to follow Christ is unlike any other religion, he does not say, fill yourself up so that you can come to me. God says, I am coming from heaven to you. What you could not do for yourself, I will do for you. You don't just go to a moment in a tank. You allow yourself to be all the way in me. I am enveloped by his grace. It's not about my capacity, it's about my covering. Some of us are obsessed with growth mindsets and capacity. Can I just say something? What would life look like if you stopped obsessed about managing yourself and put yourself in Christ and let him manage you?
Come on, that's good. Yes.
It's a game changer. Otherwise, you're worrying about something you don't have the ability to fix. So all in is a mindset and a lifestyle. For some of us, it was just a blimp on a screen and it was a part of a tradition. Tradition has never changed anybody. Amen. Now, we honor and we respect traditions, but traditions don't change us. Jesus changes us. Yes. And the great invitation from the great apostle Paul is that you are baptized all the way in Christ. And I just want to encourage you today. Do you measure up? Probably not. Like, I've never met a dad who thought he was just a great dad, ever. Never met a teacher who thought she was the best teacher and I've never met a person who thought they were at 100% potential, ever. I've never met a producer that thought they were the best producer in the world. I've never met a marriage that thought they got it all together. So like, why do we keep asking those questions? It's not what's in me. We are in a self-centered generation that has grown up taking selfies and measuring ourselves. And I'm just saying, that's too much pressure. You are a glass.
Yes.
And maybe some of you put glasses on too soon because you've been measuring yourself under the law. What you can do, what you can't do, what they say about you, how everybody else measures you. And I just invite you to baptism. Think this glass is worried about what it doesn't have? No, because it's surrounded by a limitless force. This is baptizo. Fully enveloped. Now you can be secure to talk about your weaknesses. Now you can be honest about the things about your marriage that stink. Why? Because you're not posturing or striving to be something you aren't, because you're not going to fix you anyway. Right? Can we be honest?
Yeah.
You're not going to fix it. Neither am I. Don't put me on a pedestal. I'm a pastor. I talk about the one who can fix it. Yeah. His name is Jesus. And if you're baptized into him, oh, now we can do what Paul said. I boast in my weaknesses.
Yes.
I don't post my highlight reel. I let you see where I'm really at. Yeah. Because I'm enveloped with the grace of God. It gives me permission to be honest.
Yes.
Jesus. Yes. What would the church look like if we were honest and enveloped with all the baptisms that God has? Can I invite you to a reality that baptism is a lifestyle?
Yes.
You know what you ought to do every morning? How many of you guys are like bath takers? Like seven? Okay, no, I got to get to know you. How many of you guys are shower people? Oh, I got to change some things about myself. I'll be just laying back, y'all. Hey. You know what you ought to do every morning? Every morning you get in the shower, the baptism. You get in the baptismal. Every time you get in the bath, baptismal. You ought to let that water remind you. See, that's what the water is. It's a reminder.
Yes.
That's what the water is. There's nothing spiritual about the water. It is what the water stands for. That when the water comes over me, it encompasses me. That's what the scripture says. It is clothed in Jesus. He surrounds me. My good side, my bad side, my strengths, my weaknesses are enveloped by God.
Yes.
That's why you can pour out. See, if you are a percentage, where did this thing go? I ain't picking it up. I'm trying to get my shoes wet. Listen. If you're a percentage thinker, you'll never step into purpose. Because it'll never make sense to. God invites you today to all of the baptisms because tradition will not change you. Like, go try it. You don't come out of the water brand new because you stepped in the water. It's when my life is enveloped when my life is tucked into the totality of who he is. Yes. Not my money, it's his money. Right. Not my relationships, it's his. It's not my business.
Yes.
If it's my business 7 years from now when it gets too big for me, I'm going to be on antidepressants because I'm trying to solve every issue.
Wow.
And I'm just encouraging you, be baptized.
Yeah.
Be baptized. The message of the New Testament was repent, change your mind, and be baptized. Not just in the Jordan River. I've been baptized there. It was great. A little muddy, but great. The message is not just a dip. It is a life submerged into the possibilities of who he is.
Amen.
And like maybe you'll wake up with a little bit more joy if that's your reality.
Yes.
Not posturing and striving to be something that you can never fix. So God invites you to all the baptisms, and I'm going to show you three today. It's about 300 if you had time, but some of you are in a hurry, and I get it. Let me give you the first one. Three baptisms. Clearly in Scripture, baptized into three different ecosystems, if you will, that God has for you. The first one is the baptism into God's family.
Yes.
Listen, I appreciate your attendance. I'm thankful that you're with us online and on site. And for some of you, you need to do that for a while. But at some point, God's plea to you is, let me baptize you into the people of God.
That's right.
1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13, here's what it says. It says, for we are all baptized by one spirit, what's the purpose? As to form one body.
Yes.
Some of you are walking through life and you're doing some of it alone. And when you get baptized into the family of God, you know what you do? You go through mountains with people who celebrate and valleys with people who cry with you. Do you know the church is commanded to carry your burden?
Yes.
You know why some of you are heavy? Because you're carrying your own burden.
That's right.
So God's invitation is like, be fully, fully, all the way in with your church family.
Yeah.
So like when we do groups, go all in.
Yeah.
And if you go to the first group and it's a little different, you have my permission to leave it. Go find a group and like go all the way in. Why? Because that's a baptism that you and I need. And a lot of you, you need to go to group leader training. Why? Because you providing community is surrounding people that desperately need somebody who cares, who can get a hold of God and pray with them, who can hug them, who can have their back when their mother goes to the hospital. Your group shows up. I think groups are the best thing we do.
Yeah.
But listen, the invitation to you is real simple. I think your life would be better if you weren't just tiptoeing around the pond, but going all the way in.
Amen.
I think God meets you at the level of your movement. That's what disciple means, one who moves. So there's a first baptism. Let me give you two more real quick. There's water and power. There's a baptizing the family of God. I have brothers, sisters, mothers, and fathers. Mentors, everything that I need in the family of God. Beautiful. Like, go do that. You can do that right after this service where you go join the church. Why? So that you are baptized in the family all the way in. All the way in the encouragement. All the way in the accountability, all the way in the joy that you get with being a part of God's people. Then you have water and power. I want to show you one scripture where you see two distinct different baptisms. I'm trying to get you away from a moment into a lifestyle, okay? So here, see this in scripture. Luke chapter 3 verse 16 says, John answered them, I baptize you with water. There's another baptism. But the one who is more powerful than I will come, Jesus, the straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. He, Jesus, will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Some of you may have been a believer for a while, but you're still struggling with the same thing. Nobody knows, maybe, but you're like, I can't get over the fact that I'm so bitter at my wife that we just act like we're congenial, or I've been watching this or clicking this and I've never been able to stop. You need power. I don't need the Holy Spirit to make me better than you. I need the Holy Spirit to make me better than me.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So today is Baptism Sunday, and for some of you, water is your step. Why? Because when you get baptized with water, there is a physical memory that you create where you know, I've been through some stuff. And there's some stuff that is stuck onto my life, and it needs to drown under the water. And as Jesus went into the grave, I got some stuff that needs to die.
Yeah.
And for some of you, you haven't prepared for that, but listen. We're your family. We have. When I say we've prepared, I mean we have from undergarments to flip-flops to shorts, t-shirt, a bag for your cell phone. We have everything ready. A towel. And it's warm too. Little snuggle bunny thing. What's it? Snuggle bear? It smells just like that. It's a good towel. You know why we would prepare? Because in the New Testament, people didn't go through a 7-month class on baptism. They said, you know what? Turns out God is good. And when I go under the water, when I come out, I always have a memory to remind myself and the devil that Jesus Christ has set me free from my sin, from my guilt, from my shame. And there is no past that gets to tell my future what to do. And then as we worship, remember, we only did 2 songs at the front, so we're going to do some more. Can I encourage you? Some of you worship here, so take it here. Some of you worship here, take it here. Some of you worship here, maybe go here. Carry the TV. Go to a touchdown. Do something. Star Wars. Heisman. Do something. Okay? The goal today is simple. What if our entire church, like all of us, me, you, all of us, what if all of us moved into a baptized lifestyle? Wonder how much less I would worry if I wasn't looking in the mirror measuring myself, but looking at this great Messiah who covers me. I'd be less obsessed with my capacity and more obsessed with the Creator, Jesus. So my ask of the Lord today was very simple. Would you like baptize the whole church? The whole church. Some of you, you didn't even plan in this moment, the spontaneity of the Holy Spirit, is leading you to do something that makes no sense. By the way, I told you about faith, right? It's pre-logical. Doesn't make sense ahead of time. Until you're in the moment, you're going, I didn't even know that I needed this, but there's some things that have been, maybe it's 2020 or like you're newly single and you need something to remember. There's a mistake. I feel this in my spirit. There's a mistake that somebody's made and you're beating yourself up. And what the Spirit of the Lord will do in an ordinary moment is make it supernatural so that when you come out of this water, I can even see you now in my mind's eye. As you come out, you actually feel clean for the first time in a really long time. There's a gentleman, you've been struggling with pornography for 25 years. And when you come out of this water, you know what you're going to feel for the first time in a long time? You're going to feel clean. And you're not going to be perfect tomorrow. None of us are. But it's one step deeper in the water. One step deeper in who He is. And then as people are getting baptized, the whole church, as you worship today, maybe just go from wherever you're at the beach, a little deeper. And just say, God, like, sure would love to go all in with you today. Because potential makes no sense if you measure yourself. But if you are enveloped by God, surrounded by God, maybe you could see it then. Maybe you could see what God could do through you if you were surrounded by who He is instead of staring at the mirror at yourself. And I think God invites all of us today. There's a bunch of you that didn't even plan to get baptized, and the Spirit of God is moving you right now. And do not let fear or what people think, we're going to celebrate you. Yes. Do not let that stand in the way of you having a moment with your Almighty God. He knew that you needed this moment before you were born. And for the rest of us, we're just going to worship and ask God to let us all go all the way in. Is anybody else ready to go all the way in? Come on, stand to your feet. Come on, if you're ready to go all the way in. Let's just give God a praise. Let's just celebrate Him. Come on, if you believe He's been great to you, fill the house with the sound of praise. Come on, fill this house.
Hey everyone, my name is Jake Law, and I'm the online director here at Zeal. And we hope you enjoyed this message from our You Can Do This series. Through this series, we're committing to 31 days of radical generosity and encouraging people by telling them, you can do this. If our church has made an impact in your life, we would love to partner with you in making a difference as we work to lead people to reach their full potential in Jesus Christ. You can do this by heading to zealchurch.tv/give. And if you've seen God move in your life at Zeal or through this series, we want to hear about it. All you have to do is click the link to share your story to make an impact in the lives of others. And for continued encouragement and to stay up to date with all things going on here at Zeal, make sure to follow us on all of our social media and to subscribe to us on our YouTube channel. Well, hey, we close out every single thing we do here at Zeal the same way by saying a declaration and encouraging people to go out and love God, love people, and enjoy life. And we're going to do the same thing right now. So wherever you are, say it with me. Let's go out and love God, love people, and enjoy life. And don't forget, you can do this.